Hey there. Today we're going to be talking about some research concerning coral bleaching. And as always, we're going to start with a quick introduction so that we all are on the same page to understand what the researchers did. So first off, coral reefs are really important because they protect coastlines. They're home to lots of organisms, so they provide habitat. They're huge sources of biodiversity. And we eat a lot of things from coral reefs. So corals are actually really cool animals. Here's my interpretation of a coral. And let's do a little blow up over here. So within a coral, there are single-celled organisms that photosynthesize, so little algae. And they do photosynthesis. So, just as a review, photosynthesis is when an organism takes energy from sunlight and turns it into sugars. And they do this with the help of pigments. Oops. And the most common one that you're probably familiar with is chlorophyll. Now, the really awesome thing about corals and the algae is that the algae actually take these sugars and share them with the coral. And this is a relationship called symbiosis. So the coral actually gets the sugars that the algae produce, and the algae get a safe place to live. Now, the problem is that with climate change, coral reefs are in danger. And they're in danger because we have warming oceans. And when the ocean water warms, our corals and our algae are under thermal stress. And when they're under thermal stress, this is when coral bleaching happens. And that's when the algae actually leave the corals and the corals turn white because they don't have those pigments anymore. And when corals and algae are under thermal stress, they produce these little molecules called reactive oxygen species, or ROS. And one example that you're probably familiar with is H2O2, which is hydrogen peroxide. So we can also refer to these reactive oxygen species as free radicals. And the reason that these reactive oxygen species or free radicals are bad is because they're really reactive, like the name says, and they can cause damage by reacting with things that they are not supposed to. So scientists were wondering if there was a way to reduce the amount of these reactive oxygen species to prevent bleaching. And to do this, they would have to introduce something to the corals and the algae, that system. So it needs to be small. Can't hurt anything, so no negative impacts. And it needs to work at high temperatures because we're in a thermal stress environment. So, what did our researchers actually do? Let's get into our methods. So, the first thing they did was they made some small delivery vehicles. So, they made nanoparticles and they added them to algae to make sure that the algae survived. So, they have these nanoparticles, they've got some polymers on the outside to make them easier to work with. And they added them to a beaker full of, here's our little algae in here. Okay. And then what they did was they measured growth over 25 days. The second thing they did was a pretty cool experiment where they actually introduced these nanoparticles and then measured these reactive oxygen species to see if the nanoparticles with the chemicals actually worked. So they set up an experiment that had four treatments. I'm just going to draw four beakers here. Do-do-do, 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 do-do-do. all of these have algae in them. And in two of them, they added the nanoparticles, or they added algae that had nanoparticles in them. And then in the other two, there were no nanoparticles. So these were our control beakers. All right, and then in each of these sets, one of them was at 27 degrees Celsius. So that's about 81 degrees, I think. The other one was at 34 degrees Celsius. That's about 93, I believe. And so these ones, the 34, are the ones where we have our thermal stress. So just like what would cause coral bleaching. All right. And the third thing they did was they added these nanoparticles to an organism to make sure that they could actually add them to an organism. And so they used anemones because they're easier to work with in the lab than corals are. So here's our anemone. Looks kind of like a fishbowl, sorry about that. And they added our algae with the nanoparticles to make sure that it worked. And they used a microscope to check on them. So let's talk about what they found. So the results. Now, for this first experiment where they made the nanoparticles and added them to the algae, they found that the algae took up the nanoparticles within 30 minutes. And there was no impact on growth. Yay. All right, the second part of the experiment. They found that the reactive oxygen species went down when they added the nanoparticles. So these two beakers right here, they found that the reactive oxygen species went down. And they found that it worked at both temperatures. So that's good if we have our thermal stress temperatures in the environment. And then the third part where they added the nanoparticles to the anemones, that was a success. The anemones actually took up the nanoparticles and they were able to check that with a microscope. So where does that leave us? Let us discuss. So it is great that the algae were not damaged. Yay, no algae damaged by these nanoparticles with the chemicals in them. It's great that our ROS, our reactive oxygen species, decreased even under thermal stress conditions. But there are a couple of things that the researchers identified they need to do. So they need to test on actual corals instead of just anemones. And they need to see how long the particles actually last. Do they last for a long time or do they just vanish? Now, what does this all mean in the large grand scale? What can we conclude? Well, the first thing is that coral reefs are really important, but they're hard to study. And we need new ways to study them. And one of those is with nanotechnology. And so some of the things that we can do specifically with coral reefs and nanotechnology is we can use nanotechnology to help monitor coral reefs. We can use it to help us study corals in the lab more easily. We can help them to administer chemicals like we did in this study, or vaccines if there's some kind of virus that the corals are having. And we can also use nanotechnology to manipulate DNA to increase coral resistance, to changing conditions. I think that's supposed to happen. regardless, nanotechnology is going to be one of the tools that we use to help coral reefs stay in existence. So I hope you learned something today, and have a good one.